This week at the Internet Cafe, online activism. Meet John Keeley. He's the webmaster for the Sierra Club Online. This is the IGC website. It can help you get your organization up on the net. AMILA Online is a website that supports the cause of Muslims living in America. Trudell Ean had a good idea. Let's help voters do a better job. So she started the Smart Voter website. And it doesn't matter how small your group is, even residents' associations and neighborhood associations are now using the web to further their cause. Online activism, this week at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is brought to you by Z Auction, the live online shopping experience. Additional funding from PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with PC and Mac products, toll-free technical support, and overnight delivery. And by Windows Magazine, delivering desktop, enterprise, and internet computing news, reviews, features, and how-tos for a Windows world, because the world runs on Windows. Additional funding from SoftSource Incorporated, publishers of Pro One Software, educational software for young adults.
So are you guys politically active? Do you get involved in causes and stuff like that on the web or off the web?
Actually, I haven't on the web. Most of my stuff has been sort of predating the web a few years back.
Okay.
Actually, only about 3 years in internet time.
Right.
But working with inner city kids and doing fundraisers, doing cleanups where you'd get the community to come out and help clean up an area or paint something and raise money. So I'm excited to see kind of what
the... So you do this pre-web, but now what do you think about being able to use...
Well, it would have been great, because I had to organize a thing that was, I think, five counties and, you know, a couple hundred people come out, and it would have been great to have the web to...
It's time to get back into it.
Who knows?
Jane, what are you up to?
I have always been actively involved in sort of grassroots activities, more sort of in my backyard type of thing. So I think the Internet's a great vehicle to be able to sort of pull people together and communicate more effectively and... minimize the disinformation that's out there.
It certainly allows people to do things they couldn't do before. I think what's interesting in the political activism field, it's not so much getting information, you know, like you do in other parts of the web or the internet. It's just the communication tool, the fact that you can send an email to 1,000 people, that you can target a mailing list, you can solicit volunteers to work for a cause. That's the real power of the web, in which I see lots of people doing it. Right. Anyhow, we'll find out today. We're looking at online activism this week at the Internet Cafe.
Now, you can't get much more grassroots than neighborhood activism. Now, both Doug and Priya, you're actively involved in your residents' associations, both located in Palo Alto, but not necessarily related. But you've both gotten your groups online. Now, tell me, what was the reason? I think fairly different reasons for both of you to get online. Doug, why did you decide to do this?
A lot of us were computer scientists or other related types, and we just used email and then the web for our communication, our business life, and our normal life.
So it was a logical choice.
And so we've just... carried it over into our neighborhood activism.
How about you, Priya?
Well, our neighborhood kind of came together around an issue last year where they were knocking down a number of our historic houses. And we started coming together to try and stop the city, or get the city to stop letting them do that. And one of the people that got involved was an ISP provider. And so he, we just were talking and decided that this might be a good way to get out the information in a quick fashion.
So now, what are the ways that you're using the internet? I mean, what is the main focus of your websites?
Our website covers all our activities, so it's ability to contact, updating news. I'm about to scoot off to a meeting in San Jose that was announced just last 4 days ago. So I put it up on the website, the announcement, the background information, and I put links to Yahoo Map that were primed with the address, so people could find their way to this very obscure location.
Now, let me ask you, I think somewhat in the Bay Area, especially Silicon Valley, a lot of us assume that we're all online. Do you find that for all of the residents' association members that they're all online, or do you have some issues with that?
Oh, no. We have a lot. About a third of my neighborhood are retired people. A lot are not online. We have 1,200 households, 400 are dues-paying members, and we've got 100 people on the mailing list, and we've got a rate that hits the web. So... the web and the email are just an adjunct to all our other communication means.
Okay.
Yeah, our neighborhood is also about a third retired folk, but I think that perhaps more of them are computer-enabled than in your neighborhood. I would say that probably a third of our 800 households have some form of computer access, either at work or in their homes.
So now we're talking about activism. So how has going online enabled you to change the way you were doing things, for example, with your group? You came together a year ago over a big issue.
Well, we find that a lot of people are finding out about things a lot faster. A similar example to Doug's thing with the water board, we had a house that was being demolished, and I put it up on the web and sent out email to the 100 or so folks that I have on my list, and with less than a week's notice, we had 50 people turn out to walk through the house.
So you're really getting people mobilized. Now let me ask you, you're both in Palo Alto, you've got different associations. Do you guys collaborate on issues that are related to the city overall? Is there an opportunity for collaboration, do you think?
There's a fair amount of collaboration on issues that span the neighborhood. So the so-called monster house thing, there are inter-neighborhood meetings. The notes from the meetings are posted on websites, and there's email around on those.
Yeah, I think that's one of the main issues that has involved a lot of people from different neighborhoods. Traffic is another issue. A lot of the recent debate about one of our measures, the Measure M, Measure O thing, a lot of that went on online.
Okay.
Particularly email more than the websites.
So email's pretty much driving a lot of the activity then.
Yeah.
Now let me ask you, from the city's perspective, do you think they're getting with the program? Do you think they're starting to realize that there's power with online activism?
Absolutely. I think that in the recent council election, a lot more of the council members were interested in meeting with the local residents' associations. And I also know that most of the council candidates had their own websites. So clearly they've got the idea that this is a good thing.
But they've gone online for the same reason we've gone online, because there are so many people who can access information. And they deal with the neighborhood associations because we can be nexuses for putting out information and showing where things are with not the partisan bias or...
For some people, political activism means simply voting. Well, that's okay. If the limit of your political activity is casting your ballot, there's a good website for you, too. It's called smartvoter.org, and I get this was all your idea. Or did it come from the League of Women Voters initially, Trudell?
Actually, it was the Coalition, Stewart. It's a group of nonprofits, the government, and the media that have put together this website.
All right, now what's the idea? What can I get from smartvoter.org?
Well, there have been many websites where there are candidates listed,
right,
or races listed, but Smart Voter is different in that the voter can go in, put in their address, put in their zip code, and a ballot will be pulled up specific to their location. So not only will they see their representative or senator that they can vote for, but it'll go all the way down to the local level. It might be their water board candidate.
Yeah, I went on and checked mine. I thought it was very cool. I put in my address and zip code, and it gave me all the people I could vote for. It told me where the voting place was, which is a big service right there. So I thought that was very effective. Now, do you deal with candidates only, or here in California, of course, you have lots of propositions and referendums and so on. Do you deal with that?
Yes, we do. We put on the measures and the propositions, the local bond issues. For instance, in a school district would be on there. We have the pros and the cons. The registrar of voter statements are on there on those measures, so we offer all of that information.
All right, now, is all the information on your site from the candidates, the sources themselves, or does somebody intermediate and make up some of this stuff?
Well, most of the information is from the candidates. For instance, the candidate pages that you see, the candidates do furnish that.
Okay.
However, there is also a link to the registrar of voters site, where they have submitted their information, candidate information, and that also would be on there.
So your site is really geared toward election day, right? I mean, to become an intelligent voter right before an election.
Yes, it is.
What, I mean, we're just post-election period right now, for example. What would go on there now? Do you just sort of wait till the next election starts coming?
We'll keep our site up so people can take a look at it, see how it works, see the different things that are on there and available for them. We not only have information on the candidates and the measures and the local races, but we also do links to the media that are our partners, and you'll see news and analysis.
Okay, so I could link to a news story about an election or a particular
race, and it could be in your local newspaper also, but you will have the link to it for
now,
you.
This is sort of experimental. Right now you're only available in a couple of counties in California, as I understand it?
That's right, San Mateo and Santa Clara County.
And how do you expand beyond that?
Well, the League of Women Voters will be taking it nationwide, incrementally, of course. Right now it is a pilot project, but we do plan to go out to other states.
So would you think by 2000 this could be something that's available all over the country?
I'd love that.
Yeah.
How important do you think the web is to the political process? I mean, we hear all the leveling of the playing field and empowerment and so on. Is this a really significant part of making people smarter voters, making the political process work better?
I think that it is. It brings a lot of information on local issues. For instance, voters often complain that they can't get information on local candidates, and now it's available for them on the website. And it's not, the playing field is leveled in the sense that the information is presented the same. You see the biography of the candidate. You see their three top priorities. And if you want to go further, you can go into their political philosophy, but it's looks the same when you look
you
at it.
You think we'll get to the point where we can vote on the web and really make life a lot simpler for
that
all of us?
That would be nice for all of us, it would.
Does the League have a position on using the web that way?
No, we don't.
No. I would think using the web, you're probably talking to generally younger voters, is that true?
I can't tell from the data that comes in. No.
You have any evidence that anything changes right now because of what people do or how many people actually use your site?
Evidence of what changes from people using our site, it's hard to tell if it affects their voting, but we certainly do see a lot of people coming on, especially the day before the election and the day of the election. Those hits just go from steady, steady, steady to bloop, bloop.
I'm sure you are getting smarter voters.
I think
that
we are.
Thanks a lot, Trudeau.
You're welcome, Stewart.
Shahid, you have a great site, the AMILA site. Let me see if I can get this acronym right. American Muslims Intent on Learning and Activism.
That's correct.
Okay, great. Now, this to me looks like a great site. It looks like a great organization. Mm-hmm. I want to sort of ask the tough question first, which is I know that there's been a lot of prejudice out there, especially in the American community, media perpetuated, stuff like that. You know, is this a site that sort of helps, you know, fight some of that?
Oh, definitely. Actually, that is one of the unintended consequences of the site. It really originally started out as an informational network for our members, but has since become a way to let the American community as a whole know about who we are and that we're not a threat. We have something to contribute. We want to help make the society a better one.
Right.
And we're part of the American mosaic.
Right. Now, that's interesting. So originally, your idea was this was a way to band your group together and meet new people and things like that. So how has it been successful in that?
Well, it's kind of taken on a life of its own because in addition to being the outlet for information for the non-Muslim community around us, it's really helped to tie together the very diverse and fragmented Muslim community in the Bay Area and help them give them a sense of identity and unite them for common projects, for common ideals. And we've actually gotten a vast majority of our membership in the last year from this webpage.
So actually your organization here started long before the website.
Long before the website. Right. But it's with the advent of this webpage that we've really been able to increase our membership, to start doing social service projects like the soup kitchen and things like that.
I've seen some great things.
Yeah, it's been really wonderful.
Yeah.
It's been a
You look very busy, like you must be doing something every week there.
Oh, definitely. I mean, there is something going on every week.
Right. Tell me what some of the upcoming things are.
Well, some of the upcoming things are we minister in prisons. We go to prisons and help people who are trying to turn their lives around and give them a sense of hope.
Now, is this mostly Muslim folks, or is this...
Well, it's Muslim and others as well, but mainly we focus on the Muslim community.
Right. Okay.
We do that. We do also a gift drive for poor Muslim children in the Bay Area, so that's another very important thing we do. We have constant study groups because we're trying to get people to educate themselves about Islam, just even the Muslims know, who don't know as much as they should.
Right.
And on top of that, we're also organizing to interact with the media and the community around us to help them understand us and to help us understand the American system and how it works.
Right. I actually did see a section up there where you've got some good editorials that are written by Muslims addressing the media, actually sort of letters to the editor and things like that.
Yeah, it's just one of the ways that we want to get that information out there is that webpage.
Right. Okay, so now community organizing and activism. Tell me a little bit more, like some of the tools that you use specifically on your site to get new members or just to get people involved, you know, come out for
kitchen. Well, one of the things that we did is we set up a mailing list through this webpage called AMILA.net.
Okay.
And with that, we try to keep people informed on a daily basis of all the events that are going on here in the Bay Area.
So you send out emails to all your members
every day.
Every day.
And
wow.
people subscribe through the webpage. Now what we've seen happen in the past 6 months at least is that not only are people in the Bay Area subscribing, but people all over the country and the world are subscribing.
So
because we have a lot of very interesting ideas that people are trying to catch up on.
Right.
We've gotten emails from Australia, from the UK, from Egypt, from Malaysia. And these are people who have their own ideas about how to get involved in the community, and they have something to contribute as well.
So this is having just a global reach now.
It really is.
A global
really
effect.
Is.
Now, just real quick, how do you have the time to do this?
I have a laptop with a wireless modem, so if I find 5 minutes, I do.
So this is all free time?
Yeah, it's all free time. It's all free time.
Now, Marcy, the Institute for Global Communications is a nonprofit internet service provider. Can you expand a little bit more about what the mission is of the organization?
Well, the mission of IGC, which has been around for about 12 years now, is to actually get people access to the internet, to work with organizations and individuals to provide them the tools that they need to do their work online.
Now, the online world wasn't quite like it is today 12 years ago, so I imagine that your mandate has changed somewhat over time.
The world has completely changed. You know, the adage that dog years, that one internet year is equal to 7 dog years, or whatever that was. We have changed so dramatically. 12 years ago, nobody had ever heard of the internet. Nobody had even conceived of the idea of the web. Gopher technology was just beginning to start at that point, and IGC was very much involved in getting gopher sites set up for people. So obviously over the last several years we've had to adapt our strategies to get people online, to move them more towards the web, to provide web hosting sites for them, to provide data services, database services for them.
So you're providing the infrastructure to really get these guys active, and the focus for IGC is primarily the United States. So can you give me some examples of how getting these guys online has really facilitated their activism, has amplified the work that they're doing?
Well, I think that the work that people do online, the difference between the world, activist world today and maybe 3 or 4 years ago even, is that a small group in a single area or region of the United States can get online, get on the internet, and make a global impact. For example, I got a call several weeks ago from a reporter in Florida asking me what this IGC thing was all about and what were we doing with this rocket, this plutonium rocket that was supposed to be launching from Cape Canaveral. And she said, we're getting feedback from all over the world on this, protests on this launch from all over the world, and it's all coming through the internet. So the activists, the people that use IGC in a way that they can get a regional or a local issue and make it a global issue.
Now, speaking of global issues, since you are focused primarily in the U.S., how do you access the globe? How do you access other activists in other countries?
Well, we're part of something called the Association of Progressive Communications, which is an international organization of which we are the United States node of. There are 24 other providers around the globe in all parts of the world, and in some of the most third world countries of the world that you would never even think that there'd be this kind of access. But for example, there's a Russian node, Glasnet, great name. In Russia. And we work with them to get equipment to them. It's very difficult for them, for example, to purchase the types of equipment that they need. What we forget here in the United States is that we are in a very different scale than most of the world. When we talk about bandwidth, we're talking a completely different scale than they're talking in maybe, Africa or even parts of South America. So we are really working with other APC nodes, as we call them, to keep those channels of communication open around the globe to get information both to and from other countries.
Now, what would be sample? You've got the members directory at the website that you're hosting. What would be some examples of some of the activist groups that are participants, at least in IGC?
There's hundreds of them. Off the top of my head, it's like they're all acronyms too, so it's very difficult for.
But I think the interesting point about that is that at that directory, you've actually got a number of groups. You actually organize in terms of, EcoNet, for example, and PeaceNet. So you've got it organized logically to the type of activism that these groups are.
The member services directory is an alphabetical listing, but within our homepage, the IGC homepage, we do break it down to the EcoNet, PeaceNet, LaborNet, ConflictNet, and WomensNet.
Now, John, you are the webmaster for the Sierra Club, which I think has to be one of the oldest
environmental organizations in the United States. Is that true?
I think so. We were founded in 1892, so we've been around for over
105 years. So that's a long time. Now, how does an organization that is founded on activism and founded sort of on the traditional means go to becoming an online organization as well?
Well, we started with email, actually, and people really got into email because we have people all over the country.
So before you had a website,
we just used email and email lists to get information to people and started to get people in that way. And then we started, when the web started up back in 94, I think our website.
Back in the ancient days.
Back in the ancient days, right. It does seem like it was a long time ago. But back in those days, it was a really small thing, just almost like a calling card on the web. And then it just kept building because people would add things like, the San Diego chapter decided they want to put when they were going on hiking trips, or somebody decided they were really concerned about a particular issue like global warming or international human rights and the environment, which are tied on our site.
Right. So it went from sort of just being, like you said, a calling card. I think people just thought, oh, here's a way we can put up a brochure.
Yeah.
And suddenly you were realizing, hey, there's more here that you can
and
do.
It's huge now. It started off, I think, as about 20 pages, and now we're up to over 6,000. And
6,000 pages on one site.
Yeah, I'm not even sure how many are there, because we have about 30 people working on it, like volunteers, as well as myself and one assistant.
30 people?
But there
so this is a major... Oh, really? Oh, so that's good.
Yeah, no, it's great. Every chapter does their own thing, and then we have people who work on their own section. So they're the expert for their section and for what's going on with them. It's just a grassroots kind of thing.
Right, right. Now, how many people come to visit this site on a monthly basis or on a yearly basis?
Well, this year it's been quite large. We get about 500,000 hits in a week, which roughly translates into about 20,000 people visiting, about 1,000 page views.
Every week, about 20,000 people.
About that many.
Wow.
Yeah.
So this is an amazingly powerful tool at this point.
It's huge,
Now, so how does the Sierra Club take this resource and use it to motivate people to, what are your goals? I mean, are to obviously save the environment, change political legislation, and obviously get funds and to continue your action.
We use it for information and communication. What we do is we tell people what's going on with their legislators or going on in different places, even administrative things they could do to help with the environment. One of the things we went on was clean air, because there was this change in clean air regulations to update them to 1997 science from 1970 science. And we had people send an email to Al Gore and telling him, Al, you're supposed to be this big environmentalist. Why aren't you supporting our regulations?
Right.
You know, got the administration on their side.
It actually seems to me like that's one of the Sierra Club's strongest thrust, is basically affecting, political movement, affecting the Senate and things like that. So what are some of the ways that people are doing that right now?
Mostly through email, and we use the Internet to inform people through an email list, and then we say, call this senator or this person or your senator and say, this is how I feel, and hopefully then they'll respond to that.
Oh, so people are actually reading on the site, go do this, and they're actually going and doing it.
Well, it's not on the site. Some of that's on the site and some of that's on email, and, we just tell people to tell people, tell the government what they want.
Right. Actually, I was up there earlier, and I saw someone putting a call out that the Endangered Species Act was threatened or is going to be threatened by a few folks, and there was action, go out and try to do something.
Yeah, we sort of explained our position on this new Endangered Species Act that's being, it's a compromise bill. So what does a compromise mean? You get half of whatever you had.
Right.
So they're going to take our pretty good Endangered Species Bill and water it down.
Right.
So we're trying to prevent that.
Okay, now also, one of the big things that the Sierra Club has to do is raise funds. It does great stuff out there, and it needs to keep money coming in. Have you found that the web has been valuable for that?
Oh, yeah, actually, it's been quite valuable. It's about a break-even proposition for us, which is great, because we're getting our message out, and we're actually making money at the same time. We get new memberships through our website, and we do really well. From what I hear of other nonprofits, we're one of the best for getting members to do well.
Well, you've both been involved in political activism pre-web, and now we've learned a little bit tonight. Would you like to get back in there now and start to use the net?
It definitely has some advantages. It brought a new dimension to, I think, a lot of it. It was interesting to see this AMILA group, the Muslim community here, organizing and attempting to sort of dispel some myth, and I think succeeding in actually doing that on the web, and also seeing the Sierra Club, which I think is one of the oldest environmental organizations in the United States, become fully modernized and take advantage of a global reach and calling people to action Very interesting.
Jane, and you?
Well, I covered the pretty wide gambit. I mean, we started with the Residents Association and then all the way to the Institute for Global Communications and sort of talking about global activism and how you get from one country to another. But I think through both experiences, I was reminded that, you know, it's still a small percentage of the population that has access to the Internet and is savvy with email and those types of things. So I think it's until you have that as a prolific medium, you're not going to have that complete activism that, that we
Well, a small percentage of the people are politically active, too, and maybe the web can help change that. In fact, you both said the word global, and I really like that because I think that's one of the key things in political activism. It's not a county, a city, a state, or even a country now. It's people around the world who can work together on an ecological cause, on an animal rights, a human rights cause, whatever. You know, a lot of the activists want world government kind of thing. Well, now you have world communication. I think it can lead to that. And with something like Smart Voter, the lady I talked to, with intelligent, informed voters, I think the web can have a huge effect on political activism. Anyhow, that's it, online activism. We'll see you next week again at CyberSmith here on the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is brought to you by Z Auction, the live online shopping experience. Additional funding from PC Connection and Mac Connection, the catalog and online superstore with PC and Mac products, toll-free technical support, and overnight delivery. And by Windows Magazine, delivering desktop, enterprise, and internet computing news, reviews, features, and how-tos for a Windows world, because the world runs on Windows. Additional funding from SoftSource Incorporated, publishers of Pro One Software, educational software for young adults. To purchase a videotape copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-310-7850. Please specify the show number and the topic.